Good morning. Good morning. It is great to see you this morning. I am so glad that you are here as we come together to worship the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. How many of you glad to be here this morning? Amen. That was about 90% of you. I'm glad to see that. The other 10%, by the time you leave here, we hope that you will feel the same way. But we are glad that we can come together on a day like today and worship. We got a lot of good stuff in store for us. I know that because I was here for the early service, and it was a tremendous time of worship. And hope that you will join with all your heart in singing and praising the Lord as we do spend some time together this morning. If you would, take out your bulletin and find that piece that looks like this. You'll have to tear it off of yours. I've already torn mine. But we would like everyone, whether you're a guest or a member, to tear that out, fill it out, and drop it in the offering plate as that comes by a little bit later in the service, because we want to have a record of your attendance. And if you're visiting with us, we love our guests, and we'd love to have just a little bit of contact information from you. I promise we're not going to bombard you with a bunch of stuff. If you give us a cell phone number, we'll send you a text message. Give us an email address, we'll send you an email. You give us a mailing address, we'll send you a card. And I promise you we're not going to come visit you unless you want us to, but we do want to let you know that we are glad that you are here today worshiping with us on this Lord's Day. So just fill that out, drop it in the offering plate on the back side. There's a place down at the bottom for prayer requests, and we do pray for every one of these requests. We have a prayer team that prays every day, Monday through Friday, for each of these requests. We all pray on the weekends, and then your staff prays for these when we meet for staff meetings. So give us the opportunity to pray for you. I know that we will do exactly that. A couple of quick announcements. You read your bulletin. How many of you would like me to read the bulletin to you today? Anybody? I didn't think so. You know what that means? You need to read it yourself, all right? Because there's a lot of stuff in this bulletin. Miss Glenda does not work hard on this every week for you not to read this. So, amen. So read this and see what's coming up. We got a lot of stuff happening. Don't want you to miss out on it. But do remember, tonight is small group. Now, I know some of you are planning on watching the Super Bowl tonight. Well, if you do your small group just right, you'll be done in time to catch the last part of the first quarter, all right? And then you can go home and watch the next 4 or 5 hours of the game, all right? So you won't miss much, but we do have small group. My group will meet back here at 5. Small groups meet at 4. If you'd like to be a part of a small group, I would encourage you to do that. There's no better way to make connections with people and to see what God is doing, what He wants to do in your heart and your life, than getting involved in a small group. So let me know if you're interested. We will get you where you need to go. We're so thankful that we have the family of Miss Jane Wilder with us today. Not everybody's here for the service, but we got a good bunch of them here, and we're so thankful for them. We're praying for them today. Miss Jane's funeral is at 2:00 this afternoon, visitation prior to that. So pray for the family as they go through this time. It's a tough time, but it's a good time too, because it's a celebration of a life well lived. And we want to pray together today as we start this service. We want to pray for them. We want to pray for all of our folks who are sick, and we got a ton of people who are sick today. So let's join our hearts together in prayer as we begin. Father, we're grateful to you that we can come to worship you on this beautiful day. Lord, this is the day that you have created, and we do rejoice, and we are glad in it. So Father, today as we celebrate who you are, as we celebrate whose we are, remind us that we're here because of what Jesus did for us on Calvary's cross. Because he died, was buried, and rose again, we can have life abundant and life eternal. And we can know that today beyond a shadow of a doubt. So I pray that you would speak to our hearts as you transform our minds, as you conform our wills to yours. Lord, help us be receptive and open to the voice of your Spirit. Minister to this family today. Father, I know that as they lay Miss Jane to rest, that their hearts are heavy. But I'm so thankful that they have so many great memories to keep them focused on who she was and who you are and who you were in her life. So lead us today as we worship. Bless the singing, bless the praying, bless the giving, and Father, bless the preaching, that we might hear your voice as we go through this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
I like reading from the Psalms. Psalms 28:7 says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and I am helped. The song that we're going to sing is about having faith like Daniel and Moses and David. So hope you, if you know it, the words will be up there. Sing with us and clap or whatever. All right, here we go.
Not a warrior, too afraid to lose. I feel unqualified for what you're calling me to do. Lord, with your strength, got no excuse. These broken people are exactly who you use.
So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David. Lord, be my defense so I can face my
shepherd boy and made him a king. So I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror as you fight for me. I'll be a champion claiming your victory.
So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David. Lord, be my defense so I can face my giants with confidence. Ooh, 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 ooh. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand a step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. Gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand a step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the walls. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand a step out when you call.
Stand up now and sing this song with us. We all know this. We've sung this.
It is the cry of my heart. Thank you.
Father, we just thank you for this morning. Thank you for the early service. We're just moving in a powerful way in our hearts. But I pray for those grieving right now. I pray that you would just meet their needs. Be near to them right now. Let them know that you are a good, good Father. What I pray for us is we give back to where you blessed us. Lord, I just thank you for all that you do in our lives. Lord, be with us throughout the rest of this day before our small groups. Continue to work in our hearts and our minds. Thank you so much for Jesus and his sacrificial death on the cross. In his name we ask it all. Amen.
This time, kids, if you'll come down here, it is Family First Sunday, so we're going to have our kids' moment. So kids, come down front. We want the young ones and the young at heart. We'll all join together. Hey, Miss Ava. All right, hope. All right. Okay. Good job, guys. All right. So this morning, does anybody know what Brother Ben is going to preach on here in a minute? Hamp, did you happen to look? All right, adults, who knows what Brother Ben's about to preach on? Anybody? Wow, that's not very comforting. Miss Glenda, they're not reading your bulletin, sorry. All right, so Brother Ben is going to preach on how can we know who to trust, right? So how can we know who it is we can trust? So we got to know what the truth is, right? And so I want you to help me with something real quick. Let me see. Hold on. Hamp, would you like this? You want me to give it to you? Okay. Hold on. You want that one, or would you want this one? Which one do you want? This one? Why do you want this one instead of that one? Oh. When you first saw this one in my left hand, it looked pretty real, right? But when I pulled this one out, suddenly it didn't look so real anymore, right? Because when we compared it to the real thing, suddenly the fake dollar bill didn't look so real anymore, all right? You might have heard this before, but when people work at a bank, they're trained to look for what real money looks like versus fake money, because sometimes people will try and make fake money, and they call it counterfeit, and they'll try and make fake money and use it. Is that the right thing to do? No, that's the wrong thing to do, right? And so people that work at the bank are trained how to spot fake money. And what they do is they take real money and they study it very closely. And they look at it and they learn every little bit of it. Because if they learn what the real stuff looks like, then they can spot the fakes much easier. Just the way that this looks pretty good until we hold the real dollar bill up next to it. And then we can spot our fake. All right, so today in the sermon, we are going to learn how we can learn who to trust. Right? Well, in life, where does our truth come from? Does anybody know where all truth comes from? Truth comes from God. Yeah, exactly. We get truth from God. That's how we know it's true, is because it comes from God. And do you know there's a fancy word for studying the things of God? Anybody know what that word is? It's theology. Theology is the study of God, the things of God. Right? And so if we learn about God when we're here, you know what that makes you? Grayson, that makes you a theologian. Yeah. Because every time we're here, we're learning about God. We're learning the things of God. And so we might sometimes think that's a really fancy word, but that's what we're all doing. We are all being theologians, which means we're learning to study the things of God. Because if we learn what God's word says, right, if we learn what God is and how he relates to us, then we'll be able to spot the fake things in life that people say are true, but we know they're not really true, because when we hold them up next to the real truth, we'll learn the difference. All right? Let's pray real quick, and then we'll all get a chance to listen to Brother Ben's sermon. Did everybody get a children's bulletin to use? You didn't? All right. Grab one on the window over there when you get down, okay? All right, let's pray real quick. Father God, Lord, we thank you that all truth comes from you, that, Lord, you are the standard that we should measure everything by. And, Lord, we thank you for giving us your word that we know is inerrant and is true, and that we can use to measure everything of our life. Lord, be with Brother Ben right now as he brings the message to all of us, that we will all realize that we are theologians, that we are studying the things of God every day. Lord, help us to grow closer to you. Help us to be a people that love the truth and love one another. And Lord, I pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Mind if I just stay here a little while? Oh, I don't know about you, but I am ready to preach, and I hope you are ready to listen today after that choir and that ensemble. Wasn't that fantastic? Amen. We are so blessed here at First Baptist Church. I told the early service choir, I said it was good to see the greatest choir in the state of Alabama. I forgot to say that to the second service, but I meant to, all right? It's a great choir. Thank you, Brother James, for all you do in our music program. But I'm also excited because I've got good news for you, all right? You guys know how we have been praying for baby Blakely Templeton. And she has been struggling for the past over the past week, and been in pretty critical condition at Children's Hospital in Birmingham. Last week we started praying. We gave some money. Thank you for your generosity. They're taking Blakely home today. God has worked, and she is better, and we're just excited. Ben texted us earlier a little while ago and told us about that. So we're excited for the family. They get to go home, and Blakely is doing well. So if you have your Bibles this morning, turn with me to 1 John chapter 4 as we talk about who we can trust. And it's hard to know who we can trust these days, isn't it? I mean, when you go to the grocery store, you get to Walmart, you get to the checkout line, you're ready to pay with your debit card, what do? You put your hand over that pen pad, and you look around, make sure nobody's watching over your shoulder, because you're going to protect your pen, right? You don't want anybody knowing, because it's dangerous. If they get your pen, they can take all your money. Three times now, since I've been in Dadeville, I've had to get a new debit card. Three times. One time, they tried to order all these fancy rims for a truck I don't even own. Fortunately, the bank called it and said, you don't own a truck like that, do you? I said, no, I don't. But I'm telling you, you never know who you can trust. And have you ever gotten one of those phone calls? You know what I'm talking about? One of those phone calls where they say, is this Benjamin Hayes? And you say, yes. And now they've got you recorded, your voice saying yes. And now they can use your voice to do just about anything they want because you have agreed to it. Or you get the phone call that says, your Social Security number is under indictment. And if you don't give us all your money, we're going to send you to jail. Anybody here got that one yet? You just never know who you can trust. But you know, it's bad enough when it's about your finances. It's bad enough when it's about things that you really cannot control. But do you realize that today, 21st century America, we are bombarded with what the Apostle John refers to in this passage as false prophets, false teachers, false preachers. All of these TV evangelists and local prophets and all these people telling you that God always wants you to be healthy. God always wants you to be happy. God always wants you to be prosperous. And quite frankly, you know from experience that that's not always true, right? Because you're not always happy. You're not always healthy. You're not always prosperous. And if you believe the lie that you're being told, this prosperity gospel, then suddenly you start wondering, what have I done wrong? Why is God punishing me? And suddenly, because you feel guilty, you're not happy. And then you're feeling guilty because you're feeling guilty. And all of a sudden, you're in this vicious cycle that takes you farther and farther away from God. We hear conflicting messages on major biblical issues like homosexuality, sanctity of life. Preachers out there who are preaching exactly opposite of what the Bible teaches. And because there are people who want what they say to be true, they believe them, they follow them. And we live in an age where it is more and more difficult to know who we can trust. And yet it is a time when it has never been more important to know that we can trust someone. You remember the last several weeks as we've been working our way through this letter, one of the things that I've told you over and over again is the reason that John wrote this is so that we can know. So that we can know that we know that we're the sons and daughters of God, that we have been born again, bought with the blood of Jesus, and our sins have been forgiven, and we're in a right relationship with the Father. He wants us to know that we are the children of God who have been given a great calling and a great mission to serve Him. And now as we come to chapter 4 of 1 John, John wants us to know that we can know how to know who we trust. Because here's the issue that John is tackling in this passage. Look at the first slide on the screen for me. Behind every proclamation is a spirit, but not every spirit is the Spirit of God. Any time that someone stands before you with the Word of God and begins to preach the Word of God or to teach the Word of God or proclaim the Word of God or to tell you that they've got a revelation from God, understand there is a spirit behind that proclamation, but not every spirit is the Spirit of God. It's been that way from the beginning of time, all the way back to the Garden of Eden, the conflict between truth and falsehood. The devil himself tells Eve, oh no, God didn't really say that if you eat of that tree, you're going to die. And Eve bought into it because of what the Bible says. The fruit looked good, looked like it was good for food. And she bought into the lie that Satan was telling. And John's made it clear to us throughout this letter that we are either on God's side. We're either on the side of God or we're on the side of Satan. We're either a child of God or we're a child of the devil. We are on one side or the other because there is no middle ground. There's no in between. Right here in these verses, we see what John is telling us. He's saying to us, and we're going to read these here in just a second, but I want you to listen for this. Because he's saying to us that we are either on the side of divine truth or we're on the side of worldly delusion. Again, no middle ground. See, John's battling for the hearts and minds of his readers. He's fighting against those who are preaching heresy. And look at what he says beginning in verse 1 of chapter 4. He says, "Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is the spirit of the Antichrist." Now I want you to notice something here for just a second. In my Bible, the word spirit is in italics. Is it in italics in yours? You know what that means? It means that word isn't really in the Greek manuscripts. It's been added to help us understand. But what John is saying here is that this is Antichrist. He is the one who is saying that Jesus Christ has not come in the flesh. And John continues, he says, "You have heard he was coming, but I'm telling you, he is now already in the world. And he is in the world today. So look what he says in verse 4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. They are of the world. They are from the world. They come out of the world. Therefore, they speak as of the world, and the world hears them. We, John says, are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. By this we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Now let me put this in context for you this morning as we look at this passage of Scripture. Because see, both in John's day and in our day, both in the first century and in the 21st century, the church depends and has depended on the ministry of people who have been given spiritual gifts to proclaim the truth of God's Word. That's what Paul says in Romans. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians. It's what Paul says in the book of Ephesians. It's what John was going through in his day. They depend, the church depends on those who have been gifted spiritually to speak and teach the truth of God's Word. The problem was that in John's day, the emphasis was being placed on the spectacular gifts. Remember what Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 13? There was this problem in the church at Corinth. Everybody wanted to have the gift of tongues. They wanted to speak in tongues because it was a supernatural gift. It was spectacular. It's a whole lot more glamorous than the gift of helps or the gift of administration. The problem is that the gift of tongues is subjective. People can hear what they want to hear, and that's been the problem throughout history. Now, please understand something. I believe in all of the spiritual gifts. I believe in the spiritual gift of speaking in tongues, but I believe that there's a way that it's to be practiced in the church, and most churches never practice it in that way. Got to follow the Word of God. But in John's church, they were looking to those who had the gift of tongues, those who had the gift of prophecy, who would stand before them and say, this is what God is telling us that we're supposed to be doing. And the problem was that only the people who were speaking knew whether God had really told them that or not, because the gifts are subjective in nature. So here's the question that John is trying to answer for the people of his day and for our day as well. How do you distinguish between the genuine work of the Holy Spirit, who has sent his Holy Spirit to give us those spiritual gifts, and the counterfeit message of Satan? Because everything that God does that is good and holy and righteous, the devil tries to counterfeit. Just like that fake dollar bill that Forrest pulled out of his billfold a while ago. By the way, be careful if he gives you a dollar, okay? Just watch him pretty closely. In the most basic sense, how do we know if a speaker is from God? How do we know if a Bible teacher can be trusted? And John says the only way that we can know is if we test the spirits whether they are of God. The problem with that is that most of our churches, especially Baptist churches, we never teach how to do that. We never tell anybody how to test the spirits. Today I want to change that, because I want to give you what John has given us here, and there are three tests that he gives us in this passage that must be applied if we are going to discern between true teachers and false teachers. And the first thing that we have to do is consider the content of their message. Now listen, we're exposed to many of these false teachers that John says have gone out into the world. The problem is that they're persuasive, they're charismatic, they have a great smile, and they're always so very positive about everything. You got a picture of one of them right now? You think of who is like that? And understand, even the false teachers may seem to speak the truth. Even the false teachers may even stress the importance of Jesus' life and his teachings. They're going to say things like, yes, Jesus was a good man. Yes, Jesus was a great teacher. Yes, we should emulate his lifestyle. But you know what they'll never tell you? They'll never tell you that Jesus is the only way of salvation. That it's only by the grace of God through faith in His Son who died on Calvary's cross for your sins, was buried, but on the third day rose again. That's the only way that you're going to have a relationship with the Father. They'll never tell you that if you don't accept Jesus, if you don't receive Him into your life as personal Lord and Savior that He longs to be, that you're going to spend an eternity in hell. They'll never tell you the whole truth of God's Word. They'll sound good, but they'll never tell you the whole truth. So here's what John says. If we want to know whether we can trust our teachers, our preachers, our pastors, the first step in testing the content of their message is to determine if they teach total truth. Remember what the Old Testament said about knowing whether a prophet was a true prophet or a false prophet? Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 22. God tells Moses that the way you know that a prophet is truly a prophet from God, everything that he says, every prophecy that he utters will come true. 100%. He could tell you 999 prophecies that come true and then tell you one that doesn't, and he's a false prophet. And God says he must be put to death. Now here's the thing. We don't have many prophets standing in our pulpits today proclaiming, "Thus saith the Lord," anymore. Or do we? Because, see, I'm of the opinion that every time someone takes the Word of God and stands before a group of people and says, "I've got a message that I want to share with you," and they start teaching the Word, they're saying exactly that. "Thus says the Lord." The problem is, are they speaking truth? Or are they speaking error? There's only one way we'll know that. There's only one way we know whether they are speaking the truth or whether they're speaking error. It's that everything they say must be measured against the infallible authority of God's inspired holy word. Remember 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 and 17? The Apostle Paul says this: "All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." In other words, what God has given us and what we call the Holy Bible is everything we need to know who He is, everything we need to know what He's done, everything we need to understand what our lives are supposed to be like, everything we need to understand the mission that He has given to us. And so if anyone comes to you and says, "I have a revelation from God, and it doesn't match what's in this book," run. Because the Bible says they're false prophets. I don't care how smart the preacher is, how educated he is, how charismatic he is. If what he is saying doesn't agree with God's Word 100%, then he is a false prophet. Now, can I take you down another path, just briefly? In John's Gospel, he tells us that Jesus is the living Word of God. The living Word of God come down to earth as a man to show us how to be saved and how to live a life that is pleasing to the Father. To believe the Word means that we need to understand exactly who Jesus is. And that's what John says here in verse 2. He says, "You want to test the spirits? Know this, every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God, and every spirit that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God." Second part of the first test is this: not only must they teach total truth, they must confess the incarnate Christ. And I'm going to tell you what that means here in just a minute. But in John's church, he had two groups that he was battling, two groups of heretics who were fighting it out for the hearts and minds of the people in his church. There were those who were saying that Jesus is not eternal deity. And then there were those who were saying Jesus was not historical humanity. In other words, they were saying that Jesus was not divine and that the Christ was not human. They're saying that when Jesus was baptized, the Christ Spirit descended from heaven and rested on Him, but before He went to the cross, the Christ Spirit left Him and went back into heaven. Now, I'm going to tell you something. What the Bible says is just this: Jesus Christ was fully God, come to earth fully man. Now, I don't know how many math majors we have out there, but I can tell you this is not going to sit well with you. Because here's what the Bible says. The Bible says Jesus was 100% God. And Jesus was 100% man. And there's no way that our earthly math can do it. Even Common Core can't get you there. But when God decides to do something, he doesn't worry about the principles we live by. He brings the two together, and 100% God and 100% man comes together as the one true and living God. John says, you want to know if this is a true teacher, then what's he confessing with his mouth? Now here's the thing. As believers, we've been given knowledge. The Holy Spirit provides it for us. The Holy Spirit teaches us. And we recognize whether a person is inspired by the Holy Spirit by who they say Jesus is. Look at the word there in verse 2. In my Bible, it's translated as confesses. It could be translated as authority in your Bible. In fact, a lot of the translations do that. But that word is the word homologein, and it could be translated as an unwavering confession that is more than verbal acceptance. You know what that means? It means it is a forthright, open declaration of where we stand and what we believe. We stand firm upon this foundation that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, come in the flesh to dwell among us. That's why the content of their message is so important. That's test one. Test number two is this. We must evaluate the confession of their faith. Now, I'm not talking about the confession we've just spoken of in verse 2. This is a little bit different. Look at verse 3. John reemphasizes for us. He reinforces the truth confession of every believer. Again, telling us there is no middle ground. We're either with God or we're against him. Because, see, all of humanity, in John's mind, is divided into two camps. We're either indwelled by the Holy Spirit of God, or we have joined ourselves with the Antichrist. Ooh, man. It's one thing to say somebody's saved and somebody's lost, right? But what John says, either you're saved, you're a child of God, you're a believer, or you're working with the devil himself incarnate. Listen to me. This verse is not about faith versus unbelief. It's not. I want to show you something. Look at the James 2:19. I think it's on the screen there. James said this. You believe that there's one God. You do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. Listen to me. There are a lot of people out there who say, yeah, I believe in God. But that's no better than the devil. He knows that God has always existed. He knows that Jesus was born of a virgin. He knows that Jesus died on the cross of Calvary. He knows that Jesus rose again. He knows that Jesus is seated at the right hand of God the Father. The demons themselves know, and they tremble, because you know what they've done? They've read the rest of the story. They went to the end. They've seen what the Bible says, that God wins. See, this is not about faith versus unbelief. This is about anti-Christian rebellion against God. It's failure to acknowledge the true identity of Jesus, yes. But John links it to the activity of the Antichrist. You know, the Antichrist, the one Paul talks about in his letters, the one that we see in the book of Revelation, the one who will come in the last days and stand in opposition to everything that is godly and holy and righteous, the one who will wage war on the saints, the one that will be defeated in the last days. John says, listen, if you're not with God, you're with the enemy. We know this Antichrist is coming in the last days, but we also know that he is right here, right now, in the spirit of falsehood. So we must evaluate the confession of their faith. How do we do that? Well, when we evaluate that confession of faith, we have to look at their personal acknowledgement of Jesus' lordship. Is Jesus Lord of their lives. Here's the neat thing about what John does here in these verses. He begins to point us to this great difference between what it means to live in Christ Jesus and what it means to live in the world. In fact, the word that John uses for world here in verse 3 is the word cosmos. And that word is talking about the world of men, but it's the realm of Antichrist. It's the place where the principalities and powers of this dark world rule and reign, what the Apostle Paul was talking about. He wants us to understand that the world refers to all that is opposed to God and all that is opposed to His purposes. To live in the world is to fight against God. But to live in Christ is to surrender our hearts to Him, to surrender our lives to Him, to surrender our entire being to Him, to profess with our mouths, yes, that's what Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, but also to profess through our actions that He truly is Lord of our lives. I want you to see something here, because everywhere we've looked in this letter, what we've read is that obedience to the Father isn't about lip service. It's about life service. We don't just say that we obey God. We obey God. We don't just say that we love God. We love God. We don't just say that we love others. We actively love others. See, it's more than just saying it. It's living it out in all that we do. So what John is telling us here is that the second part of this test, if we're truly going to evaluate their confession of faith, it must be accompanied by correct conduct. Right living. Their walk and their talk have to match. Now let me show you something. This isn't just about determining the spirit that is within our teachers and our preachers and our pastors. See, what John wants to do through this letter is to make sure we know that we know that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are the sons and the daughters of God. So you can take these tests and know whether the spirit that is within you is the spirit of truth or the spirit of falsehood. Now, in this letter, John's already given us two conditions, for living life as true children of God. Back in chapter 1, he says we must live in the light as He is in the light. That means we have to walk the walk that He's called us to. We must be obedient to the commands of Jesus. Then in chapter 3, he says we are to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our brothers and sisters in Christ if we truly are the children of God. And now in chapter 4, he says you have to reject worldliness because the world is in opposition to God. That means that we must be determined not to be anchored to a society that does not know God, a society that does not love God, a society that does not worship God, a society that does not live in accordance with His Word. Do you know what is so sad about so many Christians? They take hold of God with one hand, all that they've got, everything they can. They hold tight to Him. They're persevering to the end. And then they're reaching back into the world. Not so they can grab lost people and drag them into the light of God's love. Not so they can rescue the perishing and care for the dying, which is our calling according to the Word of God. But so that they can hold on to that old lifestyle, those old habits, live those same ways that we used to live. And inevitably we find ourselves, when we do that, stumbling into sin over and over again because we grab hold of the old habits. And instead of walking in the newness of life that He has given to us through His Son, Jesus Christ, we find ourselves walking in the darkness of our old life. So it must be correct conduct to go along with the correct confession. Then John gives us one more test that we need to look at this morning. And it's more than the content of the message they're proclaiming. It's more than the confession of their faith as to whom they serve. But the third test is going to surprise you. Because what John says is that we can test the spirits by checking the character of their audience. Look at verse 5. It says, they're of the world. Therefore they speak as of the world. And the world hears them. You know what John's saying? The character, the makeup of their audience is vital proof of the spirit of the teacher. The world hears and the world pays attention to the false prophets because their message originates in the world from which they come. Now think about this. If you've ever been in a foreign country, you know, like New York, and all you hear is some foreign language around you, you have no idea what they're saying, what do? You immediately look for somebody you can talk to. I mean, if you ever want to try this out, when you get home and you got cable TV, find one of those Spanish-speaking channels and watch it for a while. You're going to turn it to another channel because you don't know a thing that they're saying. You don't get it. Or maybe, think about it this way. I don't mean to offend anybody here, okay? Not with this. Other things I mean to offend you with, but not this, all right? What news channel do you watch? If you're conservative, for the most part, you watch Fox News. If you're a liberal, for the most part, you watch CNN. That's just the way it is. Think about it this way. Who do you hang out with? Most likely, it's people who think like you, who talk like you, who act like you, who believe like you. Because here's the principle John wants us to understand, and it's profound. Like attracts like. False teachers, those who follow them, don't derive from God. They belong to the world of Antichrist. They speak his language. So the lost world pays attention to the false teachers because that message resonates with the evil desires of their own hearts. Like attracts like. Then we come to verse 6. John says, we're of God. He who knows God hears us. You remember what Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 27? He said, the sheep know their shepherd. The word that John uses here for knows is the Greek word gnoskon, and it's present tense, and it means a continuous, growing relationship. In other words, when we know God in this continuous, growing relationship, we're going to pay attention to the true teachers. Because we who are God's children know him in a deeply intimate and personal way. We know the voice of the shepherd, and we follow him. Now, folks, I'm going to tell you something. This test is decisive. This test is determinative. People will gravitate to, they'll have an affinity for that confession and teaching with which they are like-minded. The world doesn't recognize Jesus, so they don't like what we have to say. The world hates God, so they don't like what we have to teach. The world rejects us because they have rejected him. But here's the good news, and I'm going to finish with this, I promise. Look at verse 4. I skipped over it on purpose. Look at verse 4. John says, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Who? The false teachers. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Well, a lot of times we use this verse to talk about the fact that because of the indwelling Holy Spirit in our lives, we're able to stand strong in the face of persecution. We're able to stand strong against the temptations that come upon us. We're able to stand when the trials and tribulations of life just get so heavy that we can't hardly bear them. And it's true. All of that's true. Because of the one true and living God that indwells the life of the believer, we have the strength to overcome. And if you haven't experienced that in your life, flip over to the end of the book and see we've overcome. But do you know what John was really talking about in this verse? He wants us to know that false teachers cannot deceive true believers. Did you hear me? False teachers cannot deceive true believers because we've been given the gift of the Holy Spirit, and because of that, all believers know that we have the ability to discern true and false spirits, to distinguish between what is truth and what is falsehood. Have you ever met anybody for the first time that just instantly made you uncomfortable? Have you ever been listening to someone teaching the Word and you just had this uneasy sense that what they were saying just didn't match up with your understanding of the Bible? Or maybe that you knew the words coming out of his mouth didn't match up to the life that he was living. That's called discernment. And God gives that to his children. And when you couple that spirit of discernment with these tests that John has given us, we will never fall for the false teachers who are like wolves in sheep's clothing, whose only purpose is to kill and to steal and to destroy. John says, by this, we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. I'm going to ask if you would to bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment, because I want you to think about this, and I want it just be between you and God. Here's the question. Are you able to discern between truth and falsehood when it comes to God's Word? Listen, even more than that, what John is telling us here is that if we are the sons and daughters of God, we immediately recognize the spirit of Antichrist as it confronts us in everything that it does. We know that God is not in it. And in knowing that, we can know whether we are of God or of the world. That's what I want you to ask yourself today. Are you of God? Or are you of the world? That's what John's writing for, so that you can know beyond a shadow of a doubt whether you truly are saved or lost, because there is no in between. You're either saved to the fullest, not only to escape heaven, but to serve the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, or you're lost and you're headed for an eternity in hell. There is no middle ground. Father, I pray that even now your Holy Spirit is whispering into the hearts and minds of every person here that what this preacher is preaching is absolute truth from your Word. Father, the way they can know is to test the spirits that are within them. Lead us, I pray, in this time of invitation. In Jesus' name. Let's stand together and sing our hymn of invitation today. This is not going to be one of those evangelistic invitations where I'm begging you to come to know Jesus Christ. I hope you do. And if you don't, I want you to come and let me share with you from God's Word. This is one of those invitations where you just got to do business with God. What's He saying to your heart today? Spirit of truth? Spirit of falsehood? I'm right here. You come, whatever you need. Let me pray.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. Thank you.
thank you for coming today, being a part of this service. Pray for the events of this afternoon. Pray for this family as they walk through this deep, dark valley, because we know the Good Shepherd's with them, but we want you to be with us in spirit as we make that journey. Funeral's at 2 o'clock. Be right here in this sanctuary. All right? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for loving us, for the gift of your Son, for the joy that is ours because he lives. Lead us as we leave this place to celebrate you in spirit and in truth. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.